tonight. We're going to talk to you about financial aid. I always said if I became the supervisor of guidance somewhere, I would invite this person to come do this presentation. I've heard him speak many times on this and other topics. And as you might imagine, financial aid could be a very dry topic. Well, John is anything but dry, as you're going to find out. He's going to help you understand things, and I think he's going to keep you interested and also somewhat entertained. John and I go way back. When I was a college student, he worked at the old Trenton State. Any Trenton Staters here? Okay. So John was there years ago. He was a parent at my first job, Notre Dame High School, where I was the guidance counselor for his oldest son, John, who I found out is doing very well now. It is always good to hear. He worked at HESA for a bit, the state financial aid authority, and now he's the director of enrollment down at Richard Stockton College, down below Atlantic City. So I'm going to turn it over to him. Hopefully you'll be able to keep up. John Iacovelli, thanks for coming out.
Thanks, Tony. Good evening, everybody. Now, in that introduction, you probably heard a little error that Tony made. Did he say HESA or HESA? HESA. HESA. We got him on that. I have to tease him. I love Tony. He's great. As Tony said, financial aid can be a very dull subject. I'm going to try to not make it that. Let me give you a little bit of a background here. He gave me a good introduction, and obviously I've been doing this for a long, long time. But I have something that trumps all of the professional experience. And the one thing that I have that trumps the professional experience is the fact that I am the father of three. I put all three through college. Parents in the room, I'm not rubbing it in, but I'm done. And some of you are just getting started. And after those three and 12 full years of self-induced poverty, I'm just glad it's all over with. But anyway, because I've been doing this so long, I have some youngins on my staff, some 20-somethings and 30-somethings, so we call them the youngins, especially since I'm the old man in the office. And they say it affectionately, I'm the old man. But they figured something out last year. They know that I do something like 30 to 40 of these presentations around the state every year, and I've been doing it for over 35 years. It's very difficult for them to wrap around their head that the old man has done this well over 1,000 times. They just get a big kick out of that. Well, when you've done something for 1,000 plus times, even a dummy like me learns some efficiencies. And here's one of those efficiencies. Over the next 60 to 65 minutes, I'm going to hit you with a ton of information on financial aid, and I'm not going to stop. So please don't put your hand up. I'll take any of your questions afterwards, but right now I'm going to go from A to Z. Hopefully you got your pens ready, and we're going to go. And if you have any questions, write them down, and then we'll get them at the end. Fair enough? Okay, let's get started. As the title says, demystifying the process. We're here to try to simplify or demystify the process for you. Over the years, I can't tell you how many parents have said to me in the past, I'd rather be filling out my taxes than filling out the blankety-blank financial aid form. I don't understand that thing. So I'm hoping after tonight you have some familiarity and some comfort level with filling out and doing the process of financial aid. Now, before we get rolling in the real nitty-gritty stuff, I wanted to put this screen in so that I can give you a different perception of financial aid from instead of just a parent's perception, the other side of the desk, the professional financial aid officer, and what they're thinking. So I thought I'd put this one in because I can tell you this. If I'm breaking a new person into the profession of financial aid, in the first day, in the first few hours of the first day, they're going to learn three things. One, you are here to evaluate the family's ability to pay educational costs. You see, in chapter 1, verse 1 of the book of financial aid, that's what we have to do. So I know in your mind, you're thinking, I want to fill this out, see what I can get. And we want to find that out too. But to find out what you're going to get, we got to know what you can do. And so that's what, first and foremost, that's why you're filling out the FAFSA. First and foremost, you're filling it out so we can evaluate the family's ability to pay. Number two, you're going to learn real quick that we're distributing a limited resources in an equitable manner. Key word there, limited. There's not enough to go around. There's billions and billions of dollars, but yet there seems to never be enough to go around. I put a financial aid package together for $15,000, and you're disappointed because you thought it would be 20. I put one together for $8,000, and you're disappointed because you thought it should have been 12 or 13. It's part of the business. And then number three, we're here to provide a balance of gift aid and self-help aid. These are terms or euphemisms that you want to be familiar with so they don't throw you off. If you hear the term gift aid, they're talking about grants and scholarships, and we're going to talk about a lot of those in just a second. If they're talking about self-help, if you hear that term, they're talking about loans and any work or work study that you might be able to get on campus. Okay? So just two terms that I wanted to throw out there so you understood them. And as I said, from the perspective of the financial aid officer. Now, let's get into it. Remember, we were going to simplify or demystify. So here's a simple thing for you. The next two slides. Four sources, four types. Everybody can remember that. Four sources, four types. Here's the four sources of aid. The federal government with all of its programs. We'll be going through those programs in a second. The state, where I used to work when Tony was giving you my introduction, New Jersey Higher Education Student Assistance Authority, or HESA. Okay? That's the state. Excuse me. The university or college that you go to, that's another source. And then private money. On the private money side, I like to break it down into two components. Local private and national private. On the local side, your expert is sitting in the audience. His name is Tony Mormile and anybody on his staff. So if there are any local scholarships, you want to go to the guidance office because they know about those. Whether it's a local chamber of commerce or a local Kiwanis club or a local Rotary club or whatever it is, it usually is going to go through some memorial fund that somebody put together for Lawrence High School, whatever it is. If it's local, go through Tony. If it's national, towards the end of my presentation, I'm going to show you how you can get involved with national ones as well. Okay? So four sources and four types. Scholarships, grants, loans, and employment opportunities. I want to start with employment opportunities for two reasons. Number one, get it out of the way. And number two, to give you some clarity with it. I'm going to need this water. I can tell. Okay. Now, with employment opportunities, after you fill out the financial aid form, and it goes to the colleges are going to put together what's called the financial aid package for you. It's called a package because it might have a lot of different elements in it. Sometimes it has one or two things in it. Sometimes it might have five, six, seven things in it. So they call it packaging. Packaging the awards. You'll hear that. One of the things that they may package for you is something called the Federal College Work Study Program. The Federal College Work Study Program. If you show need, they might offer your son or daughter the chance to have a little job on campus. It'll only be about 8 to 12 hours a week. No big deal. Okay? One thing that you have to understand is even if they don't offer you the federal college work study program, either because they can't or they didn't show need, you can still work on campus. Let me use my college as an example. At Stockton, from September through May, we'll have approximately 750 students working on campus. But only about 270 of them, right around that mark, are in this federal college work study program I'm talking about. The other, close to 500 of them, are just on regular campus employment. And you know what? In all those years that I was at Trenton State, now the College of New Jersey, and all those years that my wife worked at Rider University, it was the same. It's basically a two-thirds, one-third split. So, what's the moral of the story? If you want your son or daughter to work on campus, and even though you didn't get federal college work study, they can. How do you get a job on campus? The same way you get a job in a little small town. you hustle around. You get your name out. You know where you want to work. You know what skills you have. You go find out. I have work-study people in my financial aid office. I have work-study people in my and workers in my admissions side of it. All over the place, they get jobs. Okay? Now, if you're new to this process, if you are a parent who's like a rookie having your kid going off to college, you're new at this stuff, there's a tendency to sometimes think, oh, thank you, Mr. Iacovelli, for telling me about work, but I want my son or daughter to concentrate on their studies. Can't tell you how many times I've heard that. Anytime I hear, I want them to concentrate on their studies, in my mind, I'm thinking, uh-oh, rookie. I didn't really realize what's going on here. It's a rookie. All right? Because there's almost like a physics principle that I can give you. It's almost like a principle of life, nature. Give a college kid time to waste, and they will waste it. Very good. Very good class. Let me give you some statistics to prove my point. I always look this up. From Maine to Hawaii, there are approximately 15 million traditional age college students. This is actually close to 19, 20 million full college students, but I'm talking about traditional age. On a 4.0 scale, and I look at this up every year, on a 4.0 scale, the average GPA consistently year after year stays somewhere between 2.75 and 2.79 every year. Every time I look it up, it's almost the same thing. If I pull out the cohort that work on campus, guess what theirs is? Theirs is closer to 2.85, 2.88. So statistically, significantly different. You see? So the old saying of, I want my son to concentrate, or I want my daughter to concentrate. No. If they want to work, they can work. And what's good about it is, we're so concentrating on the expenses of room and board and tuition and fees, because we have to, it's expensive, that we sometimes forget that that child of ours is a living, breathing human being, which means they're a consumer. They're going to need money. So they're either going to hit you for a 20 every time they walk in the door, or they're going to have a little job that might help to keep them going. So if they need to go out with their friends or a midnight hoagie or go to the movies or something, no big deal. All right? So there's college work study and campus employment. Now, let's look at the difference between scholarships and grants. When you hear scholarship, 99 out of 100 times, they're talking about something that's merit-based. I guess we have to leave. Are the periods changing? All right. If you have to fill out a FAFSA or you have to show need, it's usually a grant or grant in aid. So merit-based and need-based. So here, merit-based, more likely a scholarship. And what are some of the things you can get a scholarship in? Well, the obvious ones like athletics. Or what if your son or daughter has a really high academic profile? High GPA, high class rank, high SAT scores. School may want to offer them an academic scholarship. Okay? Maybe your son or daughter has a skill or a talent that the school is looking for. It could be in music. It could be in art or dance. A lot of different things. So all different types of scholarships, merit-based. But those same schools, if you show need, many of them, will have a grant and aid program. So let me give you an example, a real-life example, so you can see it better. And since we're so close to the school, we're going to use Rider as an example. We're going to say that your son or daughter is interested in going to Rider University. And it just so happens that your son or daughter is one of the best soccer players in all of Mercer County. So that means the coach at Rider is very, very interested in your son or daughter. Now, because it's soccer and not a revenue-generating sport like football and basketball, your chances of getting a full athletic scholarship are slim and none, and as the old saying goes, slim left down. Okay? But the coach is here, he's very interested, and he wants to offer you a partial scholarship. Maybe it's $10,000 or $15,000. Okay? That is an athletic scholarship. Merit-based, right? Because it's athletic. Now, you turn around and fill out your financial aid form. It goes through the financial aid office at Rider, and it shows that you have need. And in that need, besides the $10,000 or $15,000 that they offered you from an athletic standpoint, they're able to offer you another $10,000 or $15,000 because you showed need in a Rider grant and aid. See the difference? Same package, and in the same package, you could have both elements. You could have something that's scholarship-based, and you could have something that's need-based, which is a grant or grant need. Okay? So I like to use that as an example so you get a feel for how merit-based and need-based work. All right, let's go on to the grants. And now that we've learned this, we know that grants, if the term is used properly by everyone, you have to show need. The largest grant on the federal side of it is something called the Pell Grant. This is something very important to understand so you don't get frustrated with the process. In 1971, the federal government took all of these, like all straggling all over the place type little financial aid programs that were out, and put them all together and put them under what's called Title IV. Title IV regulations under the U.S. Department of Education back in 71. And when they did that, and they created their grants, both the Pell, well, at that time it was called BEOG, but when they recreated Pell and SEOG, by legislative intent, federal grants were always intended for the highest need, lowest income families and students. Everybody get that? Highest need, lowest income. So here you are, you're filling out your FAFSA, you don't know this. You fill it out, federal processor sends it to the schools that you want it to be sent to, and it comes back, and statistically speaking, probably well over half, if not 80% of the people in this room, you're not going to be eligible for a Pell Grant. And so you get frustrated. Oh, I spent 2 or 3 hours filling that stupid thing out. First thing I got back was negative, saying I'm not eligible. Well, you might not be eligible for Pell, but you might be eligible for the other one. So that's why I want you to hang in there, you know? There's a lot of different programs out there. Now, if you are eligible for Pell, and not only are you eligible, but you're at the highest level of eligibility, which is what they call zero EFC, zero expected family contribution, that school might not only offer you the Pell, but they also might give you what's called a Supplemental Educational Opportunity Grant, or SEOG. We've kind of given it a nickname. We call it Super Pell, because for those who are not only eligible for Pell, but you're eligible at the highest level of Pell, you might get the SEOG as well. But those are the federal grants. And remember, highest need, lowest income. Now, the biggest one for the state is called TAG, or Tuition Aid Grant. Also by legislative intent, this time state legislature, not federal, that is meant to have a larger tent, so to speak, to help a larger swath of people. And let me give you some statistics that prove that. Last year, New Jersey Higher Ed, HESA, distributed to a little over 77,000 students something in the tune of $233 or $234 million in TAG. Now, we got some poor folk in New Jersey, but not 77,000 families worth. You follow me? Now, if you compare how much Pell from the federal side was distributed in the state to the TAG, Pell was something like $40 or $45 million less distributed in the state than the TAG that was distributed in the state. So you see what I'm saying? So even if you're in the process, don't get so frustrated if you're not eligible for Pell. There's other things out there that you might be eligible for. That's the moral of the story, so to speak. That's the good news. The bad news, some of your little darlings are already telling you, I'm not staying in state. I'm going here, there, wherever they're going. If you go out of state, you can't take a state grant with you. I'm going to show you a product that you can take out of state. It's a loan a little later on, but that you can't take out of state. Okay? All right. Institutional grants? Well, we kind of went through that, didn't we, when I gave you the rider example, right? And then the private ones, like I said, towards the end, we're going to go through a national way. The local ones, you're going to go through Tony and the staff. So those are the grants. Now, listen up. Statistically speaking, I'm about to go through the most important slide in my presentation. Why do I say it that way? I say it that way because when you look at the numbers, when you look at these statistics of all the billions of dollars that are distributed as financial aid in colleges, it's a 70%, 30% split. 70% is self-help. Remember that term? Remember that term from my last one? Self-help, loans and work study, 70% is that. 30% is grants and scholarships. Now, to further depress you on that note, there is something that the College Board puts out. You know the College Board. The first thing you think of with the College Board is the kids' SATs, right? But they do other products and services as well. One of the things they've been doing for decades, they put out this definitive report, Trends in Student Aid. They do it every year. And what you don't realize is there's quotes in the news, in the national news, almost every year from it. You just don't realize the sources. But I have to because I'm in the profession. I got to read Trends in Student Aid. It's bad. If anybody here suffers from insomnia and you want to have a natural remedy, you don't want any of these PM things that they have, just go out to collegeboard.org on the right, left-hand side, look up Trends in Student Aid, start reading that sucker. I'm telling you, about 15, 20 minutes, you'll be out. But anyway, if you look at Trends in Student Aid, and you go back to 88, 89, or 89, 90, it was a 70, 30 split then, too. 70% grants and scholarships, 30% loans. So in 20, 22 years, we've done the old 180. And you're going to find out why right now as I explain the loans to you. The way to simplify the loans is this. I want you to think in terms of first tier and second tier. So let's go through the first tier loans. At the top, you see it says Federal Perkins Loan Program. It is the third and last of the federal campus-based programs. Remember the first two? College Work Study and SEOJ, remember? Now, the third and final one, the Federal Perkins Loan. If it's offered to you, it has a very tight range. The smallest ones I've ever seen are $500 to $1,000 a year. The largest one I've ever seen, and I think it's because of the limits they put on the Perkins Loan, I don't think I've ever seen one larger, I don't care how expensive your school is, I don't think I've ever seen one larger than $2,500 a year. So it's a nice little loan. It's to the student, 5% simple interest. You don't begin to pay it off until 6 months after you graduate or terminate your college career. If your son or daughter is offered one, I highly recommend that you take it. Okay? But the big boy in the first tier loans, the most popular and the one that everybody uses, is the next one. See where it says Federal Direct Loan Program? I don't care if your son or daughter is going off to a two-year or a four-year school, a public or a private school, or a post-for-profit school after high school, like the University of Phoenix or Lincoln, I don't care where you go. Any size-shaped school, they're all using the Federal Direct Loan Program. Parents, some of you were in college in the 70s and 80s, and you might remember going to your bank and getting this little form and having it filled out and go get $2,500, the old Guaranteed Student Loan Program, the old GSL. Gone. Out of here. Everybody's going through Federal Direct. Now, under it, you see two terms that you want to be familiar with. Subsidized and unsubsidized. If you show need on your FAFSA, as it gets processed and it gets off to the college, if you show need, your loan's going to be subsidized. If you don't show need, you can still get the loan, but it's unsubsidized. Parents, what do we mean by subsidized and unsubsidized? Well, whether it's a college loan, whether it's a loan in your home, which we don't call a home loan anymore, we call it a mortgage, whether it's a car loan, whether it's a personal loan, a loan is a loan is a loan. And when you sign that legal piece of paper called a promissory note, which you legally do for any formal loan that you take, no matter what you name it, by the time the ink dries, what is happening? Interest. Remember the theme music from 60 Minutes, the news show. Right? Somebody's paying the interest. If you show need on your FAFSA, that means it's going to be subsidized. So while your child's in school, for those 4 years that they're in school, the feds are eating or paying that accruing interest. If you didn't show need, they've given you the loan, but you're responsible for the accruing interest. And I am here to tell you that if you do get any loan, I don't care if it's a first tier or a second tier loan, if you get any loan that is unsubsidized, I am giving you a bit of advice, both as a professional and a parent. You do everything in your financial power, everything in your financial power, to pay that accruing interest on a monthly or quarterly basis. Why? Because the purchase of a college education is not only large, it is unique. When you buy a home, do you buy a new home 4 years in a row? No. If you bought a new car, did you enjoy the experience so much that you bought four cars in a row without trading? I loved it so much, I kept buying new cars. Of course you don't. But that's what you do in education, isn't it? You buy the freshman year, then you buy the sophomore year, then you buy the... You got it. So, if you had borrowed $10,000 for each of the 4 years your little darling's getting their degree, how much have you borrowed? $40,000? Well, that's good math, but you don't know anything about loans, right? Because if you've not paid that accruing interest, if we had a little calculator here, it's going to come out somewhere around $46,000 to $48,000, depending on where you're at. That's why I say to you, if at all possible, pay accruing interest on any unsubsidized loan that you're getting. All right, let's look at the loan limits. In the freshman year, it's $3,500. In the sophomore year, second year, it's $4,500. Junior and senior year, $5,500. And about three, maybe four summers ago, Congress looked at this and said, well, when you look at the cost of education, that's pretty low. We got to do something about it. They didn't do much, but at least they threw another $2,000. Now, of course, that $2,000 has to be unsubsidized. So, if your child is going off to college in the freshman year from the federal government, first tier loans, the most you can borrow is $3,500 plus $2,000, correct? Now, how many of you, I know you've been talking to your children, how many of you in the room have a child who's already expressed to you a really strong interest in going to a private college? Put your hand up. One of the private schools. One of them. Just which one? Monmouth? Ah, you're going to get off easy. Cost of attendance in Monmouth, somewhere between $44,000 and $46,000. I saw a hand up in the back. White shirt.
Gettysburg.
Now we're getting up a little higher. Yeah, it's only 44. Now we're up to like 52, 54. Who else? Who are we going to go with? Johnson and Wales. We're almost on a scale now. We're going 50, now we're up to around 56, 57 for Johnson and Wales. Oh, so what do we got? What do we got?
Widener.
Oh, Widener? You're getting a break. It's like Monmouth. Not, it's merely only 44, 46. There you go. Finally, somebody wanted to break through. Somebody wanted to get through and say, let me get the big boy in here. GW, one of the most expensive schools in the country. As expensive as any Ivy League school you can go to. Cost of attendance, easily $64,000, $65,000 in 1 year. Now, let's do some math together, shall we? $65,000 minus $5,500. We're not doing too good, are we? Not even 10%, is it? Remember I said 30, 70, 70, 30? How do we get there? You're starting to find out. For many of you, some of the decisions that will be made will almost force the family not to just use first-tier loans. You're going to have to use second-tier loans. And what I'm using as a descriptor, second-tier, are really called in the business alternative or supplemental loans. You might want to write that down or remember it. Alternative or supplemental loans. The federal government has one, and it's right in the middle of the page. See where it says PLUS? You know what that acronym stands for? Parent loan for undergraduate students. Who do you think's paying that sucker off? Yeah. The feds aren't very good at marketing, but they at least tell you clearly up front what's going on. I'm not a big fan of the PLUS loan. The state has one. Let's put that up there. It's called NJ Class. Having been in the business a long time and doing a lot of these speeches, not only for parents, but for professional organizations in financial aid and everything, as I go around the country, I have to tell you something. NJ Class is the best supplemental loan program in the country, in my opinion. Best one in the country. You usually don't hear that about New Jersey. If we're at the top of a list, usually that list isn't a very good list. State property taxes. We're pretty high on that one, aren't we? Bridges that are condemned and need repair. I think we're pretty high on that one. Interstate roadways that need repair. We're high on that. Well, here's one that might be kind of good. It's the best one in the country. And unlike the state grants, this is portable. If your kid's telling you they're going out of state, like Widener or like GW, you can take it with them. You don't have to stay at Monmouth or Ryder or Stockton to get it. And notice what I kind of put a little dotted line around, too. That's called option two on NJ Class. And it's where you are paying the immediate interest only while the student's in school, so to reduce that so it doesn't go up. Another little show of hands here so I can explain to you why I think class, for 9 out of 10 people, if not more, is the best way to go. You learned something about me earlier. I told you I put 3 kids through college. How many of you have more than one to put through college? Put your hand up high and then look around. Just look around. Put your hand up and look around. You only have one. What, are you smarter than everybody else? Between you and her over here, she didn't put her hand up either. Oh, well, that's different. So then you're the smart one here. You only have one to put through school. Not that we're jealous. The point of the matter is this. If you have 2 or 3 or even 4 to put through school, you don't have a 4-year financial problem. That's only with one child. You have what I have. You have an 8-year or a 12-year or a 16-year fiscal challenge, if you want to put it that way. One of the nice things about NJ Class is that the student can be both the student and the borrower. The parent is the cosigner. So if you have a second or a third child that you need to put through, and you get involved with the Federal Plus Loan Program, by the time you get to the 3rd year or the 4th year of the first child, you're already gummed up. You're not going to be able to help the second one or the third one. I've seen people easily get into $800, $1,150 per month payments. If you've already got an $1,100 a month payment, and then here comes little junior along, and you're ready to put in through. So, again, for a multi-child family, more likely than not, class is going to work better for you. Okay, we have now gone through part one of my presentation. We're now going to take a 4-second intermission. So that I can get a drink. Okay, intermission's over. I wanted in that first part to go through all of the different major programs. And because I'm a visual person, I want you to imagine that behind me is not just that screen, but what's behind me are cubbies, almost like you'd see at a gym. You know, someplace where you can throw that extra t-shirt or a towel in? There's cubbies all behind me. But in this case, each one of those cubbies is labeled with one of the loan, work, study, scholarships, or grants that I mentioned to you. Okay? So I want you to get a visual of that. There's like 15, 20 cubbies behind me, all marked off with what the program is. Because now, in the second part, I'm going to show you the process of financial aid. I'm going to show you how financial aid people package the financial aid and how they're going to work those cubbies to put that package together for your son or daughter. Okay? So let's get started. Again, at the top, I don't care what school you go to, 2-year, 4-year, public, private, doesn't matter. Everybody's going to want you to file a free application for federal student aid. For some of the higher priced competitive institutions, they may also want you to fill out something called CSS profile. That's not free, but you might have to fill it out. So for instance, since it was already mentioned, George Washington University would be a good example of a school that's going to want not only the FAFSA, but they want you to fill out the CSS profile. Schools like Lehigh, Lafayette, Bucknell, Villanova, Holy Cross, Wake Forest, Boston College, Boston U, Yeah, they're going to want you to fill out the CSS profile. Monmouth, Rider, St. Chubb, LaSalle, they're private schools too. They don't need CSS profile. You follow me? So you get the trend of it. All right? Most important thing on this slide is at the bottom. Application deadlines. Since in most families, the responsibility for financial aid falls on the parent, then, quite frankly, it's up to the parent to know what the freshman deadlines are for the top 4 to 6 schools on your student's list. Yeah, I know, it can change every 15 minutes. You ask them today, and then you ask them on Friday, and it's a different list. But when you're ready to file the FAFSA, you need to know what their top schools are, because you want to go out on those websites to make sure that you're not missing their freshman deadline. Now, since it was brought up, let's take a GW as an example. Private expensive schools are going to have fairly early deadlines, somewhere between late January and mid-February. I don't think any of them go past February 10th or February 15th. Now think about that. You only get your W-2 form sometime in January. It's almost impossible for the vast majority of us to get our taxes done before we have to fill out the FAFSA. And we'll talk about that a little bit later on, what we have to do with estimates if you have to do that. And we'll also look at the cycle. But don't miss a deadline. If you miss a deadline, then that means you're not the priority. Will you still get loans if you're eligible for them? Yeah. Would you still get, if you're in-state, TAG if you're eligible? Yeah. Would you still get your Pell? Yeah. But all those other ones, you would not be the priority. So any of those institutional grant names or the scholarship monies, if you're late, you might lose out, okay? So look on those websites and make sure you're not missing a deadline and get it submitted. Get your FAFSA in before that deadline, that published deadline for the freshman. All right. Now, remember, as a senior, you can't begin the process officially until January 1st of the senior year. It's the earliest you can fill the thing out. Okay? And this is where you go. www.fafsa.gov. Now, for laughs and giggles, you go home tonight and take your own little laptop and Google one term, FAFSA. Just put it in, F-A-F-S-A. And I'll bet you my house what comes up is FAFSA.com. You see, there's a guy out there who last time I was out there was 4 or 5 months ago, it might have gone up. But when I was out there, for $89.95, he'll help you fill out the free application for federal student aid. So, if you're dumb enough to get to the wrong spot, he's smart enough to take your money. Now get this, and you're not going to believe this one. When you go on FAFSA.com, the first 3 or 4 pages looks exactly like the federal FAFSA form. As a matter of fact, you wouldn't know the difference until about the 4th or 5th page when he asks you, how are you going to pay the $89.95? Through Visa or Discover, because you can't take cash. Isn't that amazing that it would look exactly the same? So again, FAFSA.gov, not FAFSA.com, unless you want to give away some of your money. And what are we doing? The most important acronym of all. You are filling out the FAFSA to collect the family's personal financial information so that we can calculate an EFC, expected family contribution. And we're going to work that into the formula. You're going to see it in a couple of minutes. All right, show and tell time. I'm going to show it to you so you get familiar with it. When you're ready to fill out a FAFSA, it's a one-step, two-step operation. Step one, because it's all electronic, you're going to get a personal identification number, or PIN, P-I-N, personal identification number. You're going to have one for the parent, and you're going to have one for each of the students going off to college, because for every student that goes off to college, you have to fill out a different FAFSA. If you had two going to college, you're filling out two FAFSAs. If you have three going to college, you're filling out three FAFSAs. All right? So every student would have their own PIN, and the parent PIN can be used for each of their students, whether it's 1, 2, 3, 7, whatever. Okay? And that's where you go to get it. I don't even take 5 minutes. I always tease parents. I said, the longest part of this is going to be when you get on the site, you sitting there deciding, what are you going to use? Let's see, is it we're going to use the dog's name? Maybe the second child's birth date? Whatever. But once you put it in, they come right back to you within a minute and say, yeah, it's been validated, it's proof. So now you got your electronic signatures. That's what you're doing. You're getting an electronic signature for you, an electronic signature for the student in question. That's what you're doing. Now, once you have that, remember, step one, step two, then you're going to this site. This is what the FAFSA website looks like. Now, if I were more talented, a PowerPoint creator, I would have been able to see on the side was a little cursor on the right hand side. See a little cursor? Like if I could drag it down, you could see more. All right. I'm not showing you the full front screen on FAFSA. But if I could show you the full front screen, there's a lot of writing down towards the bottom. One thing in particular you might be interested in. When you're on that front page, you can do this tonight. You can go out there tonight. Do it. Go out there and see it. At the bottom, you'll see it says FAFSA Forecaster. That's a good one to write down. FAFSA, the number 4, caster, CASTER. In a nutshell, what's FAFSA Forecaster? If you click on it, it's a place where you can practice. Since, well, we're really in trouble now. That's the second time. We didn't leave. Am I going to get detention? Well, they don't do that. I'm not. That's only Notre Dame. They're not. Do you have detention here? You do? See? I thought it was only Catholic schools did that stuff. All right. So that's where you go, okay, with this. All right? And just practice. Because you can't do it officially until after January 1st. But if you want to get used to some of the questions, if you want to even have them do a mock EFC for you, and of course, all the writing will tell you, this is not official. But if you want to, you can go out there for 20 minutes, half hour, and play around with it. Give you some familiarity if you want to practice. Okay? So that's the end of show and tell. Step one, step two. You get the pin, then you're ready to go out and do the FAFSA on FAFSA.gov. All right. Now, what you're going to find when you're out there, there's something like 105 or 106 questions. I can assure you, I'm not going to sit here and go through every question with you right now. Like I said, I'm stupid, but not that stupid. But what I can do is I get a lot of data. I get a lot of rich data. Between 11 and 12 million families fill out a FAFSA every year. So almost like the IRS, you can tell where people are making common mistakes or common errors. You get really good data. And so instead of going through all 100 and something, here's your top 5, and we're going to talk about these so you can avoid those and not have delays in the processing. Number 1, correct name, social security number, and date of birth. I know when I first saw this, the first thing on my mind was, these kids are going to college. If you can't get your name and date of birth right, then you shouldn't be going to college. Stupid kid you've been. But it's a little more innocent than that. Let me give you a couple examples of how people get messed up on that first one. And it is the main place. It's number one at the top there because it's the number one place where people make errors. Okay? Being a good Catholic boy, when I was growing up, I went to Catholic grammar school. And in second grade, I met a friend. All through grammar school, we were tight. We were buddies. Okay? His name was Chicky Schaefer. Priests called him Chicky. Nuns called him Chicky. If he was over my house playing, my mother called down, Chicky, what's there for dinner? Sure, Mrs. Iacovelli, that'd be great. Thank you. Never heard of anybody else. Chicky this and Chicky that. Chicky. Dumbo here, it took me about, until we were like fourth or fifth grade, I forgot exactly when. But eventually, I actually asked him a question one day. He says, is your name really Chicky? That's all I ever heard, Chicky. No, John, it's Charles Francis. Charles Francis Schaefer. Just everybody since birth, they call me Chicky. Matter of fact, we caught up as adults. He has 2 children, I have my 3. And I know for a fact that on his checkbook, it says Chicky Schaefer. Everything's Chicky this and Chicky that. There's one thing that doesn't say Chicky on it. And that's that little ugly-looking card called your Social Security card. You ever see that stupid thing? Right? It says Charles Francis there. And guess what? If he puts Chicky on his FAFSA, somewhere between 7 to 10 day delay, maybe more. Why? Because the federal processor does a Social Security match for security reasons. So what's the moral of the story? Whatever's on your card, that's what goes there. Now, I hadn't gotten this question before, but I was at a high school a week ago, and on that one, the lady asked the question. She goes, well, I got married 22 years ago. I never changed my Social Security card. It still has my maiden name on it. Guess what? Until you change it, you're going to have a problem when you fill out the FAFSA. So you're lucky you came to see me, because you have from now until January 1st, 2nd, or 3rd, whenever you're going to fill out the FAFSA. Go change it. Because if that number doesn't equate, you're out. At least for 7 to 10 days until they get the verification. You don't want to go through that. Staying with number one, there's a second reason why this one causes a problem. Again, 99 out of 100, if not 999 out of 1,000 times, the parent is the one filling out the FAFSA. Yet when you look at the language and the architecture that the federal government uses, your name, your thing, yours. Like you're the one sitting down, they're yours. So if you're not reading or watching what you're doing, I can't tell you how many hundreds of people put the parental information and data in the student section, because they start with the student section first, and vice versa. Happens all the time. So don't be a victim of that. That's why it's number one. Number two, number of people in the household. I put this one here for a reason as well. So it's not just that, it's for other reasons. When you get to the real FAFSA and you start clicking through every one of those 106 questions, they are very, very thorough at the federal government on giving you as much help, information on every one of those questions. As a matter of fact, if I took what they have as instructions on every one of those questions, it would be as thick as War and Peace. It would be like this. So I'm certainly not here to tell you, read all the instructions. I've been doing this for 37 plus years. I haven't read all the instructions. I don't have that much time. But I'm going to tell you this. There's certain areas you should read the instructions. And there's about 4 or 5 paragraphs when you see the question called number of people in the household. Click on those instructions. Take your time with that one. Because this one can be a tricky one. Because common sense tells you that they're using the English language the same way you would. Number of people in the household. I can count them up. I know who's living here. What they really should be saying here is the number of people we'll recognize in the household to put on the FAFSA, if you want to be more articulate with it. Let me give you 2 examples. These happen all the time. About 2 or 3 years ago, Pop died. And after Pop died, Mom moved in with us. She still had part of Pop's pension, and she was getting a little bit of Social Security money on her own, too. Well, she's in the household. I didn't feel like reading the instructions. Common sense tells me it's my mom. I can put her on the form. They can. And we'll recognize them. Example number 2. My oldest son. He's about 24, 25 years old. Great kid. Still trying to find himself. I'm not quite sure what he wants to do in life. Still in the same room he was at when he was 15. He's on the video game right now. I can call him for you, but I don't know if he'd hear you. But he'll be down for dinner. That's my kid. That's flesh and blood. Number in the household? I don't even think twice. Of course I'm going to put him on. Yeah, shouldn't do that. Because we read the instructions, they're not recognizing him because of his age and where he's at. So, 2 quick examples, and you get the story. On that one, read the instructions. Number 3, divorced and remarried households. This is one of those ones that frustrates parents because there's no wiggle room. There's no appeal to it. It is what it is, as a famous New Jersey philosopher once said. And what it is this. When you're filling out a FAFSA and you're in a divorced situation, they want the information from the custodial parent. They use other terms as well, but who's the child living with the most? You know, the 2 of you split, who do they live with the most? That's you're the custodial parent. Now, did that custodial parent remarry, which means there's now a step-parent in the household? If you did, then you must put both the custodial parent and the step-parent's information on the FAFSA. What about my wife or husband? You've divorced them. They're not on the FAFSA. Now, if you had to fill out one of those CSS profiles, they have a whole section for the non-custodial parent that they want you to fill out. A lot more detail there. But for the federal FAFSA, It's just the custodial parent, and if the custodial parent has remarried, that's step-parent. Period. A lot of people get frustrated. They think they can appeal it with a financial aid officer. No appeal. It is what it is. Okay? Taxes paid versus taxes withheld. This is what we have to expand as well. Remember what I said to you, especially if your son or daughter is going off to a, especially the private four-year colleges, you're going to find freshman deadline dates in late January or mid-February. When you're filling out the FAFSA, they're asking you a question of, did you fill out a completed return? Are these estimates before you fill out the return? Or are you not filling one out at all? I'm not even filling out a return. If you have to make a deadline and put in estimates, I am here to tell you to be as serious about those estimates as you possibly can. As serious as you possibly can. So much so, I'm so on this, that I would say to you that if you have an accountant that you've used for years and years who helps you with your taxes, this is the time to put in that chip for being a loyal customer. You call that accountant and say, look, I know you're not going to get it done officially until late March or April, but I need your help in making an estimate here. I want to fill out my kid's financial aid form, and I'm getting you part of responsible for this. You've been helping me for 8-10 years, and I want your help. That's how vehement I am about it, okay? You want to get as exact a number in your estimates as you possibly can. Why? Because the more accurate your estimates are, if you have to use them, the more consistent the financial aid package that the college gives you will stay. The most frustrating thing for parents is for them to get a financial aid package in March or early April from a college, and then by May or June, when they've done verification and validation of your numbers and you've handed in the official copy of your tax return, it didn't hold. All right? In March, they said you were going to get this, 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 and this. And now 2 months later, you're going to get that and that. You're not happy. But you know what? They're frustrated too. They're going off the numbers you gave them. So that you have to be as accurate as you possibly can with those numbers. And finally, parental and student assets. Here's another comparison between CSS profile and the FAFSA. With the FAFSA, they're not going to ask you the worth of your home. CSS profile will. They want to know that. But if you have other properties, they do want that as an asset on the FAFSA. So maybe you have a vacation home up the Poconos or Shore or something like that. Maybe you have rental property in the area, whatever. That will go under parental assets. And finally, you can see at the bottom, it says zero is a number. That's a reminder to you of a certain point I want to make. Remember what I said, a little over 11 million, close to 12 million people fill out a FAFSA, and they're all electronically generated. You sit there, you fill it out, you hit a button that says submit, and it goes off to the process electronically. Then it goes to the colleges that you wanted it to go, 3, 4, 5 colleges you wanted it to go to. When the college gets it, you don't want them playing a guessing game. You want to be as articulate on your FAFSA as you possibly can be. So especially in the income and asset sections, if there's an income or asset question that they're asking that doesn't pertain to you, you have two choices. One, leave it blank. Two, address the question and put a zero there. Which one do you think would be more effective so that the financial aid officer knows exactly what you're doing? Put a zero in, right? Because if you don't put the zero in, there's always that question, well, did they miss it or did it not pertain to them? Now you're communicating better. Yeah, I see the question. Don't apply to me. Zero. So that's what I mean by zero is a number. And that might make it a little more efficient for you. Okay? All right. So those are the mistakes to avoid. Let's move on. Now we're going to make little financial aid officers out of you. Doesn't matter where you go. Could be Mercer County College, could be Princeton, or anything in between. Every one of the financial aid officers are working off of this formula. They're going to take the cost of attendance. They're going to subtract that EFC that you got from you filling out the FAFSA, and it's going to tell them what your need level is. Let's look at each one of these. Remember I said the most important acronym of the whole night, it's EFC. Expected family contribution. The best way I can describe it is this. I want you to think of two columns. Column one, we're looking at the student's income and any of the student's assets. They're going to take a small percentage of each and get a number at the bottom. Then in column two, they're going to look at the parental income and the parental assets. They're going to take a small percentage from each of those. But before they put those two together, they're going to take the parental side and they're going to divide it by the number of students you have going to college. Do you hear that? So let's say the parental side comes out to 10,000. Well, 10,000 divided by one is 10,000. It's all going to one kid. What if you have two in college at the same time? 10,000 divided by two means five and five. So that's important to remember for all of you who raised your hand when I raised my hand and I asked you if you had more than one to put through college. Because there's a good chance that the oldest one might be a junior or a senior, and the second one's coming up and is a freshman, right? And you went through the process the first time, and you're all frustrated. I'm not doing that again. I don't like the way it worked. I didn't get anything. The EFC was too high. And it might not work out for you, because now you got two, and it could be a whole different thing. It's a huge factor in the financial aid analysis. So that's EFC. You put those two together, that's how you get an EFC. Now, every college has to approve their cost of attendance, both to the state and to the feds. The cost of attendance is different than your immediate cost to the school. I'll repeat that. Cost of attendance is different than your immediate cost to the school. Let's use Stockton as an example, since I worked there and I give you very good, familiar numbers. Your immediate cost at Stockton will be room and board, tuition and fees and books. And the cost for that, depending on what meal plan you get, is going to be right around $24,000, somewhere between $24,000 and $24,400. That's what it's going to be. But I am approved for a cost of attendance on campus of a little over $30,000. Why? Because besides those immediate costs, as you can see, those consumer costs that I was talking to about before when we were doing work study, remember those consumer costs? I'm allowed to put them in. Same thing with GW. The good news is their cost of attendance might be $65,000, but their real billable costs are only about $57,000 or $58,000. Doesn't that make you feel better? Okay? So know the difference between the two. Cost of attendance is more. We're purposely you can put more things in it. Okay. So we've described those two. Now let's put this to practical application so you can see what I'm talking about, and it'll refer back to my little cubby holes that I had. Remember my cubbies? We're going to put packages together for you. Your child is, in our example here, your child has applied to three colleges. Column number one is Princeton. Column number two is Stockton. Column number three is Mercer County College. We've established that the cost of attendance at Princeton is $65,000, give or take a few, but you'll get the principle, right? $65,000. You fill out your FAFSA, and the EFC comes back, and it says your EFC is $15,000. Remember my formula, $65,000 minus $15,000 is $50,000. The folks at Princeton are going to try as best they can to put together a $50,000 package for you. Remember my cubbies? They're working those cubbies hard to get the $50,000, aren't they? You could have six, seven, maybe eight elements. They might not get there, but they're going to try. Example number two. Child also applied to Stockton. My cost of attendance is right around 30. 30 minus 15 is 15,000. My staff is going to do the best they can to put a $15,000 package together for you. Example number two, three, Mercer County College. Their cost of attendance is probably going to be somewhere around $12,000 or $13,000. But your EFC was higher than that. It was $15,000, wasn't it? At Mercer County, you're a no-need. But even though you're a no-need, if you were paying attention, can you still get your loans? Yes, but they're going to be unsubsidized loans. But you still get them if you needed them. And there you go. Same kid, three different schools, three different cost of attendances. What stays the same? The expected family contribution. That never changes. That's always the same. It's the cost of the school that changes. And that's why you see different packages from different schools. Okay? Now you understand how that works. Now, I referred to this a few times, and I want to hit it directly. Remember, the freshman year is the most difficult year to file financial aid. Your sophomore, junior, and senior year are much better. Why? For one big reason. In the freshman year, they're forced to scrunch you like a consumer. They're running out of time, and so you get caught in the middle. That's why you see these early, especially for the private schools, that's why you see these early deadlines of January 30th or February 10th. I had a very good friend for many, many, many years. Now he works at LaSalle. Before, he worked at Villanova. So I use Villanova as an example. Villanova, every year, looks for 1,400 to 1,500 freshmen. Very consistent. That's what they look for. How many acceptances do you think Villanova puts on the street to make sure they get that 14 or 15? What would be your best guess? What do you think? What's the first thing come to mind? 2,500? Who else? 28. The most popular number that I get when I'm talking to an audience, because you know I do this almost every night, is 5, followed by 6. 5,000, and then somebody else will say 6,000. You know what the real number is? Somewhere between 84 and 8,500. Between 84 and 8,500 students will receive a letter of acceptance from Villanova, because they know that their yield rate is somewhere between 19 and 20 21%. So that's how you get there. Now, of that 84 to 8,500, all but just a few hundred of them have filled out a FAFSA. So somewhere between 7,900 to 8,000 people need to have a financial aid package done for them, right? So let's say their deadline date was February 10th. They only have from February 10th until about March 10th, March 15th. Why? Because that's when all the decisions go out, in mass. Just like GW, in mass. They're not on rolling admission. In mass, it has to go out. So now you know why you get scrunched in that first year. It's the only year it happens. So, fast what? Pretty good one. All right, now, we're in the home stretch. As I said to you, I'm both a parent and a professional in this. And I'm going to talk to you parent to parent. So some of you might not like it, but I drove an hour and a half to get up here, so I'm going to get it out. All right? This past year, for those of you who are big news freaks, you may have seen this. Back in May, we passed a very auspicious number. You may have saw it in the news. We passed the $1 trillion mark in student loan debt. Anybody remember hearing that or reading it? $1 trillion. Hard to wrap your mind around that. 1,000 billion. Okay? By the way, that was in May. We're now up to 1.4 trillion. That over $1 trillion is held by between 45 to 50 million former and present college goers. Now, to understand how awesome that number is, I want you to also understand that of all of the credit card debt in this country, all of it, remember, there's over 320 million Americans, and most Americans have more than one credit card in their wallet or purse, okay? All right? It's a half a trillion dollars less than the $1.4 trillion owned by just 50 million present and former college goers. That's how much it is. How did we get there? We got there, from my humble opinion, without varnishing it or trying to make it nice for everybody, we got there through two main factors. One, ignorance. The other one, vanity. We seem to want to select or buy higher education almost in the same way that we have fun purchasing items that we like. We seem to do the same thing. Let me give you a little anecdotal story. True story. Many of you might recall that about, I guess it was three, maybe now as many as four, Christmases ago, the day after Christmas, the 2 days after Christmas, were spring-like. It was like really weird. It was like 66, 68 degrees. Well, the two Iacovelli girls thought it would be, at that time they were in their 20s, 20-somethings. They thought it would be a great idea for a Iacovelli family bonding If we went to Hamilton Station, got on the train, and went to New York City. Go see 30 Rock, watch the people skate, get a nice dinner. Nice, right? Now, many of you have heard that old saying. I'm going to bust it wide open. You can't teach an old dog new tricks. Right? Heard that all the time. What's standing in front of you? An old dog. Let me show you the new trick I learned just 3 years ago when I was with my daughters. We got to New York, and boy, was it tight in there. Everybody had the same idea because it was so nice of weather, so we're like this. But did you know, gentlemen, I'm going to appeal to the men in the room. They'll understand this. When you hear the name Coors, what do you think of? I know I spell it C-O-O-R-S. And after mowing the lawn, I'd like to have a little Rocky Mountain refreshment, wouldn't you? But see, the women know. They can laugh because they know how stupid we are. Coors is actually spelled K-O-R-S. And you'd be really embarrassing a fool if you didn't put Michael in front of it. Now, to prove that the old dog can learn new tricks, did you know, because I now know this, did you know that within walking distance of 30 Rockefeller Plaza, there are at least 4 Michael Kors outlets? Did you know that? There also are at least 2 Coach outlets. And I was in, at minimum, my memory's getting a little foggy on this, but I think it was either 3 or 4, what's that? What's the name of that fancy clothing store that they like? Not Abercrombie and Fitch, the other, Banana Republic, there you go. Banana Republics. Did you know that? See, in one of them, I don't know if it was the 3rd or the 4th one, my youngest one, we like to call her Peanut, she was fascinated by a Michael Kors watch. Ladies, are you familiar with the Michael Kors watches? He is. Okay. For the most part, as far as women's watches go, they're rather large, aren't they? And my daughter is kind of built like a model. She's tall, wavy. She's got like a little thin wrist. So she comes out and she's so happy. She's so proud. Dad, look at this. What do you think? I'm stupid, but I'm not that stupid. Oh, it looks great, honey. What was I really thinking? If you had a little red nose on and clown shoes with that watch, I could have you and 15 other clowns from the Ringling Brothers coming out of a Volkswagen. That's what you look like right now. But no, I was like, oh, no, it looks great, honey. She was so proud of that thing. She bought it. Personally, I think it was about $200 or $300 overpriced. But she thought it was great. And there's no harm in that, is there? She had the money. So what's the harm? None. But the problem is, we start to take those same principles when we're picking colleges. And we start what I call name chasing. If the name is bigger and it costs more, therefore it must be a better school. Let me help you with that a little bit. Let me try to help you. Okay? I've been doing this for 37 years. All right? I had 2 methods with my kids. And you can do what you want. They're your kids, you do what you want with them. But if there's one thing I've tried to hold on to, that I think my generation, and I'm a little older than you people, I'm a baby boomer. Most of you in this room are probably Gen Xers. Okay? But the one thing I try to hold on to, because both baby boomers and Gen Xers fail miserably in this for the most part, is I'm a parent first. I know that all of us put this huge effort in to be the coolest and the most popular and the most liked parent. That seems to be the trend. Just watch any reality show. If I see the Kardashians one more time, I think I'm going to shoot myself. All right? Pull my brains out. All right? But unfortunately, there is a responsibility here. And one of those responsibilities when you are a parent is you're setting standards. And we're not allowing our love of the child to be manipulated so that they can kind of almost guilt us into things that really aren't a good decision. So, what's my point? My point is this. I just went for 60, 65 minutes showing you everything I could possibly do in financial aid, and all of that pales in comparison to your son or daughter's list, what they're looking for. Their list is going to dictate this more than my financial aid guruship. And if you're a smart consumer, what you're going to do is both set standards and make sure that your child is looking at an array of places. And let me give you an example. And this is hard for me. I want you to relate this the proper way. Tony, you can help me with this. For your athletic program at Lawrence High School, who would you say your chief rival is? Who do you like to play in football and beat? Who do you like to beat in basketball? Who's like the big rival?
I'd say
Hopewell. Okay.
Or Notre Dame.
Or Notre Dame. Okay. You love to hate him, right? Okay. I feel the same way about Rowan. I really don't like Rowan. I'm at Stockton. There's one thing I like about Rowan, and it just happened last week. Their men's basketball team came in. We beat them. We put them back on the bus. Thank you. Nice competition. Come back again. Anytime you want to get your ass kicked. Come on. But in all honesty, I have to say this to you. I'm in admissions. I'm all over the state. I ask people where they're going. What are they looking for? And all the time, when somebody says to me, yeah, I'm looking at colleges. I want to be an engineer. What's the next natural question for me? What do you think? Where are you going? What are you looking at? I always hear Lehigh. I always hear Rensselaer. I always hear Bucknell. I always hear Drexel. I very rarely hear someone say to me, Rowan. It's happened, but not that much. And all those other schools that I just mentioned are between $55,000 and $65,000 a year. And Rowan's sitting there, and it's about $24,000, $25,000 a year. And in a trade journal that I saw about a year ago, they were rated in the top 10 for electrical engineering. They're right there with Georgia Tech, Purdue. So, okay. Give me another example. Mom, Dad, I'm interested in marine biology. Really? If you're interested in marine biology and you don't have Stockton on the list, you stupid is right. You are stupid. Because I'll defy you to find another program on the, repeat this, on the undergraduate level that is as good as ours. Because I've looked. I know four or five that are very good on the graduate level. Excellent on the graduate level. On the undergraduate, other than Florida Atlantic, I got no peers. Other than them, I got no one. Why am I bringing those up as examples? Because they're just a few examples of pockets of excellence that when you do your homework, you find it. And then what does that homework do for you? A very, very important thing. When your children have a list of four or five top schools, you want them to go through the entire process. I hate when people dismiss a school because of its price in September and October. I hate that. Stay with it. What I equally hate is the parent who allows the child to get emotionally attached to a college before we even know we can afford it. That's equally as bad. And that's just as much on us as it is on them, if you're not setting standards. Okay? That's all I'm trying to tell you. Just trying to give you some good advice. And I'll end with this and shut up and see if you have any questions. I had two methods. One was the Iacovelli method. You might find this a little too draconian. And then two, another one I'll show you, which I got from the editors of the Wall Street Journal. In my household, here's what I told my three kids. And understand, two of the three decided to go to very high-priced schools. You know, real high-priced schools. But I said to them, you can go anywhere you want, but we will not borrow outside of Tier 1 loans. Everybody hear that? If you're listening to my thing, Tier 1 meant the Federal Direct and the Perkins. That's it. No alternative loans. No NJ Class, no Plus, nothing from a bank. That's it. If you do the math, what I was basically telling them was you can go anywhere you want, but you're not borrowing more than $20,000, $22,000 a year. It's going to be real dumb, right? And they understood that Dad was so intense and so serious about it that I'll pull their little butts out even in the junior or the beginning of the senior year if they couldn't do it. So they understood how serious Dad was with it. Now again, that might be too draconian for you. I don't know. I liked it because all three got out with less than 20 grand over their head. 22 grand over there. This past fall, the editors of Wall Street Journal came up with a different one. I like this one, so I use it as well. Find out what your son or daughter is interested in. We'll use engineering and teaching as two examples. You're pretty sure your child wants to go into an engineering school. If you look at the U.S. Bureau of Labor Statistics, it tells you that the average starting salary the first year of being an engineer is somewhere between $60,000 and $65,000. So the editor of the Wall Street Journal was saying you shouldn't be borrowing over a four-year period more than $60,000 to $65,000. Your child comes to you and says they want to be in education. We know that from U.S. Bureau of Labor Statistics, the average starting salary across the country for teachers is right around $35,000. You should not let your child borrow more than $35,000 to go to school. Follow me? So now, I've done my homework, I've got a list of four or five schools, and I'm staying with the process all the way through. I haven't fallen in love with one yet, and I haven't dismissed anybody yet. And now, financial aid comes through, and now we can have a serious talk. You know what, honey? I really wanted you to go to that school, too. I think it'd be a great choice for you. But if you go there, we literally have to borrow somewhere between $35,000 to $40,000 a year. I don't think that's right. Oh, Mom, I hate you. Oh, I can't believe you're doing this to me. It's so embarrassing. Jimmy's father's letting me do whatever he wants. What's wrong with you? Oh, I hate you. You're going to make a choice. You're going to say, sorry, honey, but that's the way it is. Or you're going to look at each other and say, oh, we'll make it happen. I don't want her to cry. And then you become a statistic. I have hundreds and hundreds of students in New Jersey alone who graduate every year who have $80,000 to $120,000 of debt over their head, and all they have in their little tiny hands is a baccalaureate degree. They're not a doctor. They're not a lawyer. They're not a dentist. And they didn't go one of the fancy schmancy MBA schools in the world. They just have a baccalaureate degree. And they now have more, double what your first mortgage was. And if you think that's not affecting their little 20-something lives, you're crazy. I'm in college. I've seen it already. I'm actually seeing serious relationships of people in their 20s and early 30s breaking up because one of them has $130,000 of debt on and the other one has $20,000. That's how bad it's gotten, let alone delaying things like marriage and everything else. So if you think that debt's not something, it is. So I just wanted to leave that with you. I'm not trying to pressure on it. I'm just trying to parent to give you some advice. If that high-priced school is for your kid, God bless you, go. As long as you're not getting yourself in really serious debt. And if you are, you have to be strong enough and be a smart enough consumer to find the proper alternatives that are out there, and they are. Okay? I'll get off my soapbox. I hope I helped a little bit. Thank you. If you have any questions, put a hand up and we'll take your questions. If not, I get to go home. We done? Going once? Going twice? Oh, you guys are so kind and nice. Why is there a hand? I can't see in the dark, so I don't see any hand up. And they chose to sit in the back, so I can't see them. Oh, all right. It's like a concert. You put it up. Okay. Now we got some more. All right, what's the question?
Okay, so you had mentioned that the number of people in the household...
Number of people in the household is the one that I really want you to read the instructions to make sure that who you're putting down, the feds will recognize, yes.
Okay, no, because what I wanted to ask is, I mean, if you file for the person, I mean, are they automatically considered eligible or not necessarily?
I don't understand your question. You're filling out the FAFSA to see if they're eligible for aid. That's why you're filling out the FAFSA.
Right. No, but...
Okay.
Okay. I'll read the instructions. Okay. I'm good.
Alright. Anybody else? Going once? Going twice? Thanks, guys. Have a good evening. Take care.
John, thanks so much. Before you get up and go, I want to show you the guidance website. You go to Lawrence High School, then you go to guidance, and you will find this. On the left is all this good stuff. What John's talking about, what I'm responsible for, are the local scholarships, and they are all right here. November's has just been uploaded here. Ms. Coben is in charge of this, so she puts down all the local scholarships. October is underneath. Once January comes, we'll upload December. They're all right there. Okay. This video will be put right up there as soon as it's ready. It'll be done in a couple of weeks, and it'll be put up there if you want to watch it again or if you want to refer it to a friend. And finally, if you're a Twitter person, which I am new to, follow me at LTPS Guidance, which you see right down there. And over the next few weeks, I'm going to be tweeting my notes that I learned tonight from this presentation. John, that was wonderful. We appreciate everything you covered. And thanks so much for coming out. Take care.